I'm glad you are.
Mrs. Nundy and Mr. Sanghavi. And put them on the spot here in this podium. They have nowhere to run. And ask them some very personal questions. And perhaps we can start with where Vishal left off. So here you are, children of immigrants in North America. And you know, living the dream, you know, top schools. Texas has top schools, right? top schools in Morgan Stanley, you know, living the total capitalist dream of what your parents came to North America for. Very much in love, and all of a sudden, you decide to do something else. So maybe you can talk to us a little bit about that moment of madness, or that year of madness.
It still continues 17 years later. Yeah, so I think we both have different journeys of how we got here. I think for me, growing up, I used to come back to India quite often with my parents, see a lot of the disparity, and it really upset me. I guess more so because I grew up in the US and I wasn't accustomed to seeing sort of poverty at such a big level, especially with children. So being a child myself growing up, seeing other children in poverty was just shocking. We never saw that really in America. So I always wanted to do something here. I never really had the opportunity to do so. So I graduated a semester early from a University of Texas. To volunteer with street children at Grant Road Station. And to sort of Meher and Anu's point earlier, I learned more from them every single day than I could have ever imagined or ever could have ever taught them. And so they had a very, very lasting impact on me. They sort of reinforced sort of in my mind that at some point of time, I want to give a lot more time and money towards philanthropy. I was amazed at their resilience, the contentness they had on life, and how much they cared for each other, much more than I even felt I cared for my own family. I go to Morgan Stanley, which is a phenomenal institution, learned a lot, had a great time there, but realized not just at Morgan Stanley, but at many sort of corporate jobs, both in India and in the US, most people come to work actually not happy. Most people come and complain day in and day out. And that was a real wake-up call. I was a fresh graduate, I had student loans to pay off, but to see sort of children living in Mumbai with nothing, be happy with life, and people who were in investment banking who literally had everything, be upset or sort of not content, I started to question, I guess, at a very early age, what was sort of the meaning of life. And that sort of, I guess, helped me make the decision quite quickly that I would use the phenomenal skills that I learned in banking to a sector that I just was more passionate about.
And Neera?
So my journey actually was, I don't know, I think a bunch of little accidents, not fully planned. I grew up in Canada, so Canada's not the same as America, right?
Northern America.
Yes, thank you. Thank you for that. And so, you know, I was, and I have my parents here, so I'll try to be careful, but, you know, grew up in a traditional yet not traditional. So I grew up with very strong women, not realizing that the rest of the world didn't have such privileges. My mother was the first electrical engineer, my father was an engineer, and my sister and I absolutely had to do something in science or engineering. I wasn't very good at physics, and so I was like, okay, can I please do math? And they were like, I guess so. And so I was gonna be an actuary, yay. So I went off, studied math, and then I graduated in a super hot market, which I thought there was something special about myself, but there wasn't. All of Wall Street was recruiting. And so I took a job at Morgan Stanley, and that's really where I met the fire in the belly, Deval. And it was there where we started talking about this idea of Dasra, and we said, hey, wouldn't it be kind of cool if we could use whatever little skills we had? We were analysts, so there wasn't a whole lot to give up, frankly. It wasn't like Tarun giving up something when he was an MD. So although it sounds very grand, we were little people in New York City, and trying to think about, oh, can we do something more meaningful? And Deval was like, yeah, we should use our skills and we should help other nonprofits. And I was like, yeah, okay, good idea. And he's like, let's fundraise at Morgan Stanley and let's go around asking people. I was like, oh, okay, good idea. So we made this little PowerPoint and we went around and we raised money. And then Deval says, well, I'm going to go do this, and I'm going to change the world. And I said, go, you go do that. I'm going to Harvard Business School. So I went to HBS, and then after 2 years, and we were still in touch. We weren't married then, but we were still in touch, and he'd be like, I'm doing this, I'm doing that. And quite frankly, it sounded like he was having quite a lot of fun. And at that point, I had a bit of an awakening and realized I grew up with such privilege. To have grown up in Canada, to have been on Wall Street, to have been at Harvard Business School, and there they brainwash you to really be a leader that makes a difference in the world. I thought to myself, let me just take the plunge and do something meaningful. Worst case, you know, someone will give me a job.
And so you were led into this by Deval, and I suppose your love for Deval. And we'll come back to that.
There's an evening session.
So then Dasra, you know, how did you make your way back here with that specific idea and with that specific plan?
So I think a lot of it actually resonates with what Ashok Bhai was saying earlier, that we sort of started the journey in sort of just working and volunteering with NGOs and listening to them. Many of the organizations said, who are you NRIs? This is not a place to find yourself, go back. And many foundations said the same thing. And so we realized, very rightfully so, that just because you have the intent to give time or money, in no way does that give us the right to influence what's happening in these communities. And you have to actually earn that right. And so we volunteered with different organizations in Mirzapur, UP, with my now mother-in-law in Kharagpur, West Bengal, in Rajasthan, in Dharavi as well, and very slowly sort of started understanding what were some of the challenges, not that just the community faced, because honestly speaking, the staff of these NGOs knew that and were doing a phenomenal job, but more importantly, what were the challenges that these NGO workers faced? And that's really what inspired us. I mean, when we were at Morgan Stanley, we used to read Ashoka profiles of Preeti Patkar, for example, working with the second generation of sex working children in Kamathipura and thinking, wow, wouldn't it be amazing to work with somebody like Preeti and help her with her journey? Of course, she was one of the first people to say, leave, this is not a zoo, don't come to Kamathipura until you're serious about it. And that made us just work harder and create sort of that drive to really benefit the community. So it was really listening to the NGOs, understanding what they needed to be more successful, and then providing them funding, unrestricted capital, even at that stage, to help the management of these organizations perform most effectively, realizing these are the guys, as one of our donors said in the Sneha Circle, that are doing God's work. And if we can support them, that's critical versus wondering about admin cost and restricted funding and one-year grants.
Yeah, so I think at the core of why we started Dasra was very much how can we help an NGO that's doing all this great work really grow? And because we came from kind of general management, a generalist background, we ended up positioning ourselves with, hey, can we help you with pretty much anything in the beginning, in our desperate days? To then really realizing that where we were able to add value was on how do you strengthen institutions? How do you help them grow? How do you help them think about people issues? All the fundamental things that were enabling a corporate or a company to be successful, we recognized that that was equally applicable in the nonprofit sector, was one thing. I think the second thing we realized is there's something very special about being able to bridge what we saw as sort of two sides of a coin or two sides of a world, and being able to bridge with language and perspective and connection and playing that facilitating role is really where Dasra started to kind of blossom and find its ground. And I think I'm most proud of the fact that when you look at our team, the same people that are able to speak and engage with all of you are the same folks that are going into the field and working with the nonprofits. And I think that's really what this sector has needed, and that's what we've sort of evolved to try to address.
So it looks like it seems like you're a bit ahead of your time, not only in India but elsewhere, in terms of using your, thinking of a model where you can help existing NGOs, and that was because of your previous corporate background in a way, with your training and the way you were trained academically and in corporate world. Now, I met you 10 years ago, almost 10 years ago, and you had a sense of mission, but your message when it came out seemed, if I may, confused. And it was you know, quite mixed. And so when did that light bulb go off that from that time to today? Now, this was 10 years ago, so you'd been doing it for 5 years. You were a small group. I think if I remember, you had 4 or 5 people by that time. But you were hands-on, and you were trying to figure out where you can, you know, how can you grow, how can you scale, because you had sort of understood that formula that will help you grow. So what was that light bulb that got you from where you were 10 years ago to making a plan? I remember that's when you started to make scale plans, to where you are now, and where were there disagreements? And because this is a long road that you've traveled now in the last 9 or 10 years.
Yeah, I think, I mean, one of the big things or big risks, I guess, we took 8 years ago was to do this gathering. We had worked with NGOs for a decade by that time, from 99 to 2009, and we realized that we had so much learnings, and in fact, it was you and the board that helped us realize this, that we had to start sharing these learnings with the wealth that was created in this country. And so in 1999, while we came back, people like Ashish Dhawan also came back to start Chrysalis. And you've seen, you know, tremendous, and we all know the stories of wealth that was created from 99 to 2009. And while we were sort of working with these organizations and still saying, look, there's not a perfect solution, we still need to work with them, we still need to work with them, it was actually our board that said, you guys have 10 years of learning. Very few people in the country can say that today. Why don't you start sharing this knowledge with individuals of wealth and influence and power within the country? And that really is why we came to India to begin with, was to be closer to the investees versus the investors. And we said, why don't we start this exact forum 8 years ago and sort of start talking about you know, the challenges that we see in the field, start highlighting phenomenal leaders like Dr. Fernandez or Safina or others. And we got a lot of pushback. We got a lot of pushback from our own organization, including the two of us, of saying, why would we spend money to do something at the Taj? That made us want to throw up back then. We were disgusted at the fact that these conferences were at 5-star hotels and didn't move beyond that. But then we realized that was the only way we could actually meet people where they are in the donor journey. And we couldn't expect them to go to Mirzapur or to go to Bihar or to go to the same communities. We couldn't even expect them to come to Santa Cruz in our office, much less to these areas. So we said, why don't we create a platform where we could actually have the same individuals that inspire us every single day in the field talk about their experiences to a wider group. And so since that time, just to give you guys a sense of scale, we sort of managed and directed, I think, close to $10 million worth of funding our first decade. And in the last 6 to 7 years, we've sort of upped that by an additional $50 million worth of funding. And that's really where we saw that scale happen.
Thank you. So I think the aha for me was about when we decided to launch the philanthropy side. And I think where it came to was a realization that no matter how much advice or recommendation or working with these organizations to push them to scale, we were not going to be able to achieve this impact without having the money to do it. And so it almost became a responsibility of ours that, wait a second, if we have can build this network and have access to it, shouldn't we be influencing them to be able to fund, you know, this great work and fund the impact? So I think it was a little bit of a calling to say, we have to take on this responsibility and educate folks on how their giving can be more strategic. And I think feeling a sense of nationalism that there's wealth growing in this country, India's in the spotlight. There was an expectation from everywhere else that, you know, hey, are Indians ever gonna give to India? And we were like, yeah, we need to be there and facilitating some of that and how that can be.
So it'd be interesting to hear, as you then came along, what were your missteps? You know, you went through certain different directions, and as you look back in hindsight, where were your, you know, what were your assumptions that somehow didn't pan out, and how did you then mitigate those and get to where you are now, where in a way you're relaunching with a new launch pad, you know, with an organization, with a very large organization.
Yeah, so I think one of the big things, and to your point, Tarun, and I think around 2009, you're right, we were about 5-6 people. Yeah. And so we did not take risks or honestly believe in ourselves enough to hire more people. We kept thinking, and we had that realization in 2002, in fact, when the sort of dot-com burst in India, where we had a team of 5-6 people, and we had to lay them off. And that was the hardest thing we had to do, especially because they had to convince their families, like Vishal and everyone who works at Dasra had to do, to sort of be in this sector, even though they graduated from IIM Ahmedabad and other places, and many of them were not able to find jobs afterwards. And so for us, I think we were so conservative and burned from that particular experience that we said we will never hire people unless we have money in the bank for the next 2 years. And I think, again, it was the board that said, look, you guys need to take these risks, and if you falter, we are there to support you. So it's not sort of 2002 anymore, it's 2009, you've done this for a decade, and as long as you guys are at sort of the helm, we will ensure that impact is still created. So I think one of the biggest mistakes is we didn't hire early, and it was actually thanks to Malika, who's here right now from the Omidyar Network, or who was with the Omidyar Network at that time, that gave us that boost of confidence and financial capital to sort of expand from a 10 to 12 member team to now the 100 plus team we have today. So I'd say that was one of our biggest mistakes, sort of from that stage. Right.
Yeah, I mean, I think if I know it's hard to believe, but we've been around for 17 years. And so, you know, when people are like, wow, that's a really long time, it is a really, really long time. So I think we were slow. And some of it was risk averse, but believe it or not, some of it was having a family and trying to figure out how you do family and kids and Dasra. And so some of the years, you know, I could say it was trying to figure all of the personal stuff with Dasra. And so I think once I got rid of, not rid of, once I...
Where's Ayush? Ayush, hi, Mama didn't say that.
He's not
once
listening.
I figured out how to have the kids part, you know, I threw myself into Dasra, and I think that's where we both realized, okay, now we can give it all. I think what remains a challenge, and you know, I wish we had done more of this and can continue to, is just bringing people in and building them to become leaders within the organization. So you reach a certain point, as founders, the organization becomes dependent on you. But you know, we've become dependent on the organization. And so I do wish we are now growing people from within, but I do wish we brought people on earlier, that we invested, that there would be, you know, 5 of us sitting here instead of 2 of us. So I think that is one challenge, is building leadership and moving from the 2 of us. That being said, it's very hard to move. So we went through this whole strategy review last year, and you know, now that we're kicking off Dasra into it, I feel like all of a sudden, again, we've been sucked into, you know, leading a lot of where Dasra's going. But frankly, it's really exciting, and we still want to be a part of it.
So that's part of it, right? I mean, the barometer and the benchmarks keep changing and keep getting higher. So you have, you guys, you work together, you go home together, you sleep together, you eat together, you raise children together, and my hat's off to you, you're still together. So how do you do it? And I know in my time with you, we have, you know, I've sensed and seen bouts of tension where you've wanted to go in somewhat different directions. And somehow, over time, you reconcile those and you come out saying, hey, we are together in this direction. So give us some anecdotes and some thoughts about how you overcome that. How does work and marriage play together in this space as co-CEOs?
Neera is the boss on all fronts. I just listen.
That is not true.
Tough question, I know. Yeah. Came without warning.
You want to go first?
Yeah, you go first.
Yes.
Thank you, Ramesh,
yeah,
uncle.
You. It's a secret. You know, I'm not sure. I think it's a little crazy when I hear you say that, and I know other people say that too, but it's strange, I don't think about him as my husband at work. I know that's weird, but so there's a separation of the different roles to some extent that often all blur together. But, you know, if I think about the one thing that allows, I suppose, for us to continue in harmony, is that the mission of what we're trying to achieve is far greater than, you know, my little petty issues of why doesn't anybody see me as a leader, or why can't I do what I want to do? And I think similarly, you know, for Deval, what we're trying to do requires the two of us in some ways, and it requires so much more from people, that I think the ability to compromise when you put that impact and what we're trying to build ahead of everything else, I feel that that gives a bit of perspective.
Yeah. Fair enough. One last question before we throw it open. I know it's time's running out. And that last question is the future. We talked a lot about the past and where you've come from. So, next 17 years, how do you see, I mean, the one thing, obviously, one as one of the board members is a J curve. I'm sure that comes through at this stage where you hopefully make bigger impact. But how do you see the sector changing and what you do within that sector and within the development world in India changing? And I mean, what are your thoughts and, you know, your sense of optimism, areas of pessimism? So give us, and I think you're particularly well suited. You're situated, you're working from within, you've built this up, you've seen the sectors change. So give us your thoughts on the next 17.
Yeah, so I think number one, as we've been speaking from the beginning of the conversation in the morning, I think I'm confident there's a tremendous amount of new capital that's going to come into the philanthropic sector, driven primarily from sort of the top 500 families in our country. And I say that not because they're the only ones where sort of the onus should lie in giving, but I say that because if you saw an Oxfam report a few weeks ago, 58, I think, members of this country have as much wealth as 700 million members of our country. Therefore, there is more than a responsibility. It just has to happen. And I think those, again, in positions of leadership, positions of influence, positions of power, can accelerate social change like they have accelerated for-profit sort of change in the country like never before seen. So I think that's very, very exciting for us. I think that's what that's also is sort of bringing in is the ability for greater human capital to come in. And so while Dasra has been very successful at bringing in individuals at a younger age, we're now, like you guys saw from Shekhar, bringing in individuals from the corporate sector who've spent 25 years in hardcore for-profit businesses reporting directly into Deepak Parekh, who are saying, look, for the next 10 years or my next innings, I actually want to do something that I'm more excited about in life. So getting sort of the people with 20 to 25 years of corporate experience to come into the sector, I think is going to be critical in order for the absorption capacity of the sector to grow and scale. And then finally, I think everyone in this space, whether it's government, donors, philanthropists, outcome indicators is critical and impact itself. And so again, we're moving beyond the feel-good feeling of writing the check or getting the check, but more importantly, are we shifting the needle on the sustainable development goals that India and every other country has signed up to do by 2030? And so I think if these three things are put sort of in place, there's a tremendous opportunity, not only for India, but actually for the rest of the world to sort of see how frugal innovation is scaled.
I mean, I think if I think about Dasra, and a lot of our growth has been organic, the board has really helped us understand that some of the limitations of where Dasra is going to go is actually going to be the two of us. And if I think about where our strategy is going, we will be a much larger organization, and I think we will play a very important role in figuring out what works and what doesn't on the ground. And the reason that we need to be getting closer to this impact and this measurement piece is there's a sense of urgency with having to fix quite a lot of what's not working. And I think in these next, I think you gave us 18 years, how many years?
17.
17 years. In the next 17 years is gonna be India's moment. everybody is watching us in terms of we are the country that's got high GDP growth, we're gonna have a demographic dividend. So we have got to come together and solve a lot of these problems in a really accelerated way. And I think where we're seeing ourselves play a role is bringing folks together and figuring out how do we come together to be able to accelerate this. And some of our launch in the Adolescence Collaborative or the work that we're doing in democracy and governance is really important for us to take a leadership role and figure out those structures. Like the panel before, there needs to be formal structures that enables this sort of collaboration. And so I think we're gonna have to be at the forefront. We're gonna be experimenting. I think we need to take risks. And the reason that it's so exciting that families are gonna participate in this movement is it's a group of us that are gonna be able to take some of that risk to kind of move the country forward.
And your point is well made. I mean, the board has to work very closely with you for succession planning if all this is going to happen and the fruits are going to come through Dasra. I know time's running out, but we do need to throw it open to a couple of questions.
But no parents are allowed to ask questions.
No parents.
So
no parents.
Call on the parents, please.
No parents, please. However, this is the opportunity to ask even more personal questions. Yes, please.
Hi, I'm Raj Gilda, co-founder of Lend a Hand India, and I have been part of Dasra's, integral part of Dasra's journey with Lend a Hand India. I think, Neera, you gave a very cop-out answer to that difficult question of, how are you working together?
He didn't even answer.
So I think what I want to ask here is that tell us very specific examples like impact, in the same way, very specific, quantifiable instances where both of you disagreed and who won and how.
Ask him.
I guess Deval, that's fair. Neera.
Neera always wins. No, I think that's really where the board or the organization comes into play. So I think number one, and this is really not to do with hopefully just being husband and wife, but more importantly being in the sector, right? You have to put your own beliefs under what's required for this sector as a whole. I mean, it is about serving. It is about being humility, representing yourself with humility and being in service. And so I think it is about saying your opinion, saying this is what's required, but then being able to listen to as many other perspectives as you can, because while we can sit here and say we have to, for example, move the country forward, solving poverty is the most difficult thing that any civilization has ever looked at doing, and they've failed time and time again. And so realizing there is no silver bullet solution, my view may not be the only view and definitely cannot be the only view, and being open to having those conversations, whether it's internally, externally, with NGOs, with donors, with government, with experts, I think that's critical. And I think that's honestly the only thing that's holding us back as a sector is ego. And I think we're very privileged from that perspective to be a husband and wife and to be able to put our ego behind and really focus on the greater good. And I implore all of you guys, even if you don't work with your spouses, to do the same in the sector, because that's the only thing that's going to make this difference.
I have a question here.
Where's the question?
This way.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Yes.
Okay, so the question is for Deval. This is Apurva. I am Deval's brother-in-law.
Oh.
And
I don't know if that's allowed.
I think that's family.
But it is not a personal question. Deval and Neera, as you figured out that, this is phase one of the journey and the next phase will be a bit different in the roles you play at Dasra in terms of helping it scale a certain way. What advice can you give a lot of families here that have been doing philanthropic work maybe for decades, in some cases a year? What can you tell them in terms of how they can also look inwards or what they should do in terms of leadership change that could make them a lot more effective and maybe a little longer lasting or more permanent in nature and not limited to just the family's role?
Neera?
Yeah. I mean, I think it is to always aspire to broaden your perspective and to have a council of sorts. And so I think often we you know, I start to think about building Dasra in a way that's in isolation of what's going potentially on in the environment or where those needs are. So I think continuous learning to remain relevant cannot possibly happen in your own brain. And so as much as you reach out and reach out to people who know, there's a lot of experience out there. And so I feel like often we're reinventing or trying to deal with challenges that, you know, people have solved somewhere. And so I think broadening that net with how you seek advice, how you learn, how you keep your foundation relevant, I think is really important.
I would just say set higher ambitions because the billion people need it. And I think that's an issue, right? A lot of times we set ambitions from 50 years ago or even before that where the need, number one, was different. And because of the access to capital, where government was going and where even society was, those ambitions were fantastic and path-breaking. But we need to start those sort of similar path-breaking ambitions now. And I think the second, and I think Nandan Nilakani says this in one of our panels, the second you actually set a big, hairy, audacious goal, you very quickly realize that you cannot do it alone. You have to bring in partners. You have to think differently. You have to change the way you operate. And so setting much more ambitious goals, like many of you have been successful in doing in your for-profit careers, have that same sort of initiative and drive in the nonprofit space, and we'll start seeing changes that
way. Yeah, can I add one thing before you end? I think that one piece of advice I have for philanthropists is to help us founders, entrepreneurs dream. And I used to be so jealous of Shaheen because she always had Anu by her side, and I was like, I want somebody by my side that's saying you can achieve what you want and think bigger. It's not about how much money you raise now. It's not about the money I'm giving you. And it's not about what you can as an individual philanthropist contribute. But when you start to free us from that burden of incremental growth or incremental impact, you'll find it's so liberating for whoever's doing it. But those aspirations and dreams get achieved because of the kinds of individuals that they are. So my recommendation is help us dream and achieve them.
Guys, I think we have to stop. And thank you, Deval and Neera, for always making it happen. And perhaps next time we'll take that up, and next time we talk about outward looking, what you think we, the philanthropists or the others, should be doing better by you. So.